So we're trying to develop a numerical scheme for the one-dimensional diffusion equation. We developed the forward time centered space scheme for U. U is the solution of the diffusion equation. And this is an explicit scheme because the value of U on grid point J at time step L plus 1 depends only on the value of U at time step L. So that's called an explicit scheme. One of the problems with these explicit schemes for solving the initial value problems for PDEs is that for certain too large a time step, the scheme can become unstable. Okay, we usually don't like an unstable scheme because of the time step. You want to take large time steps, but then if the time step is too large, an unstable scheme will blow up. Your solutions will go towards infinity. We know that for the diffusion equation, U should be decaying in time. A dye should diffuse, become less concentrated. So I think it's interesting as a student to see how to analyze a scheme for stability. The traditional analysis is called the von Neumann stability analysis. So I'll show you now, using this forward time centered space scheme, how a too large time step can lead to an unstable scheme. Okay, so the idea here is that we try an OnSats that we will substitute into this equation to determine its stability. Okay, the OnSats that we use is to take for U sub J L, so U at the J grid point at the L time step, equals cosine, a parameter, raised to the Lth power, okay, times an exponential function, which is as a imaginary exponent. I is square root of minus 1, times K, which is a wave number, times J delta X. Okay, so this is the OnSats. So let me break this down. So U sub J at the J grid point at the Lth time step, we're going to make an OnSats, a guess for this U, equal to cosi, a parameter in our OnSats, to the Lth power. So this L here signifies time step, but this L here is actually the Lth power, times e to the I kj delta x. I is the imaginary unit, square root of minus 1. K is a what's called a wave number. It's also a parameter. J, so it's raised to the j power. Remember, j is then the grid point index, times delta x, which is the grid spacing. Okay? The idea here, then, is that if this value, the absolute value of cosi, is greater than 1 for any wave number k, for any k, then the scheme is unstable. Okay? So the solution for U is going to consist of these modes. These are called Fourier modes, are going to consist of a lot of these modes for all different values of k. Here we're only looking at a single mode. So if for any k, because the solution has all the k's in them, if for any k, this cosi ends up having a magnitude larger than 1, then as we advance in time, L is increasing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Cosi gets raised to the L power. If cosi has magnitude larger than 1, then this right-hand side is blowing up. Okay? So if it turns out cosi has magnitude larger than 1, then one of these modes in the solution is going to be blowing up. And then we say that the method is unstable then, okay? So this is our OnSats. So we have to substitute in. We're going to get a bit of a mess, but we can go for it. So if you substitute into this equation, so sub j superscript l plus 1, we'll get psi to the l plus 1 e to the I k j delta x equals psi to the l e to the I k j delta x plus delta t d over delta x squared. And then we have u sub l, u super l sub j plus 1. So we'll have a psi to the l e to the I k j plus 1 delta x minus 2 psi to the l e to the I k j delta x plus u sub j minus 1, so psi to the l e to the I k j minus 1 delta x. Okay? A bit of a mess here, a bit of a mess. So what do we do? We can divide both sides by psi to the l times e to the I k j delta x, right? And then a lot of things will cancel. So if we do that, then the left-hand side will just become psi. This term here, we're dividing exactly by this term, so that becomes 1. And then we get a plus delta t d over delta x squared. And we're dividing through by here, so the psi l goes e to the I k j delta x. So we end up with e to the I k delta x. This one, this whole term gets divided out, minus 2. And then we have a j minus 1 here, so that becomes plus e to the minus I k delta x. Okay? Now we use a well-known relation for the complex exponentials. So e to the I k delta x plus e to the minus I k delta x is twice cosine k delta x, twice cosine k delta x. So that becomes 2. So we end up equal to 1 plus 2 delta t d over delta x squared. We factor out a 2 and a cosine, and this becomes cosine k delta x minus 1. Okay? That's the result of all of this algebra. Okay, now we need to understand the meaning. So we're looking, k can be any wave number, right? We're trying to see if the magnitude of psi is larger than 1 for any k. So let's see how this behaves as we vary k. So cosine, as we vary k, cosine will go between plus 1 and minus 1. It oscillates between plus 1 and minus 1. So when cosine k delta x is plus 1 for some k, then we get 1 minus 1, so that will be 0. So then psi is equal to 1, right at the boundary of stability, right? Psi is equal to 1. And then when cosine drops from 1 to smaller values, cosine k delta x minus 1 will be negative. So this will be 1 minus some positive number. So psi will then fall down smaller than 1. So it will become stable, right? But then what can happen? Cosine k delta x goes from 1 down to minus 1, which is the maximum negative value, right? The smallest value of cosine k delta x. And that becomes minus 1 minus 1 becomes minus 2. So it's possible that 1 minus a positive number can become smaller than minus 1. If it becomes smaller than minus 1, then the scheme will become unstable, right? So if Ksi becomes smaller than minus one, then the absolute value of Ksi is greater than one, the scheme becomes unstable. So the most, so K, when cosine K delta X equals one, we're safe, but the most dangerous value of K will be when cosine K delta X is minus one. Okay, so let me write that. The most dangerous K is when cosine K delta X equals minus one, okay? So then we need to see if Ksi then can become less than negative one. So we need to see when, we need to ask the question, when does Ksi become smaller than minus one? That will be the value of that will be when the scheme becomes unstable. Okay. So since we're substituting cosine k delta x equals minus one, the question we're asking then is what is the relationship between delta t and delta x that the scheme becomes unstable? So here we have the right-hand side then will become one. And then with putting in the most dangerous value of k, so cosine k delta x is minus one. So minus one is minus two. So one minus two times two is four, delta t d over delta x squared. And for unstable, then that one will become less than minus one. So this is the condition for instability, when this right-hand side becomes smaller than minus one, okay? We can move the minus one to the left side, so that becomes two, move this to the right-hand side, and then solve for delta t, okay? So if we solve this equation for delta t, we get delta t is greater than delta x squared divided by 2 times d. And then when this is met, then the scheme is unstable. Scheme is unstable. Okay? So if our time step is too large, if the time step delta t is greater than the grid spacing squared divided by twice the diffusion constant, then the scheme will be unstable, right? That means one of these Fourier modes is going to blow up. It's going to blow up. We considered the most dangerous mode. Okay, let me try and summarize. We're trying to analyze the stability of the forward time-centered space scheme using the von Neumann stability analysis. We try an OnSats for U, which is basically an OnSats of a single Fourier mode. We do a bunch of algebra, and we can solve for this parameter, Ksi. We want to see that if Ksi, the magnitude of Ksi is greater than one for any value of K, then the scheme is unstable. Okay, so we figured out that the Ksi will be less than minus one, which is unstable, if delta t is greater than delta x squared over 2d. So this sets a limit on the size of your time step for this explicit scheme. What we'll see in the next video is that if we write down an implicit scheme, it will be unconditionally stable. So no matter what time step you take, implicit scheme will be stable. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.